$17.52. That settles my back taxes for 59 and 60.
That does it.
Gougers. All of you. Gougers.
Don't tell it to me. I make 60 bucks a week here.
Go ahead, lady. I can wait.
Thank you. Is this where you give the money in? Excuse me, is this where you give the money in?
Let me see your form, miss. I mean, did you make out a form? I mean, where are your papers?
But this is the only paper that I thought was necessary.
Oh, I can't take your check without the regular 1040 form. It's to be sure it's the correct amount according to your return.
Well, this isn't according to any return. It's just money. I want to give it to the government.
Well, this is very irregular. First of all, this is the Department of Internal Revenue. April Fool. Next.
No, please.
Next.
And then I went to see the head clerk, and then the assistant to the Secretary of Treasury, and then the Secretary of Treasury. But when I insisted on seeing the President,
is Stephenson. Victor Stephenson. And we never used that word around here. Now, Mrs. Benson, you just take one of these and try to relax. Here, dear. You know, Mrs. Crunch it. Crunch it right down. That's right. That's right. Mrs. Benson, you are obviously the victim of some inner disturbance, which, well, for the want of a better word, your guilts have led you to a state of fantasy in which, A, you're burdened with some fantastic wealth, and B, you're eager to rid yourself of it, as in the ancient ritual of exorcising some divock or evil spirit. No. This is normal. Excuse me. Yes, please don't. What? Oh, yes, put him on. Oh, hello, Fred. You investigated and... Fred. The check is good. Uh-huh. Yes. Ah, oh, thank you, Fred. I have the strangest tingling sensation in my toes.
Are you all right?
What? What happened?
Well, A, you fainted, and B, I poured water on you. I'm terribly sorry, but I didn't know what else to do.
No, it's all right. You did the right thing.
Do you faint often?
Oh, just once in a while. It's the shock of realization whenever I've been dead wrong about something. The fainting is a running away, as it were, from the reality that I'm not infallible. You see, it's been the pattern of my life from the time I was a... Wait a minute, what is this? Who's doing what to who? Or whom? Mrs. Benson. You are a young woman who is apparently worth in the neighborhood of $200 million. And for some incredible reason, you want to give it to the government. You don't need a psychiatrist. You need your head examined. Now, out of my office. Out!
No, Dr. Stephenson.
Out of my
office.
You
said something a minute ago that was very understanding and true. I never heard it expressed before. But I want your help.
Mrs.
Oh, please.
Yes. Yes, the oath I took forbids me to turn away from a cry for help. Sit down, Miss Spencer.
Oh, it was what you said about my wanting to get rid of my money, like exercising some evil spirit.
Ah, yes.
Dr. Stephenson, I think I may be some kind of a witch.
Oh, come now, Mrs. Benson. This is the 19th century, or 20th
no,
century.
No, really. Every man whose life I touch withers.
Really? Mrs. Benson, please, just turn over and try to relax. Go right ahead.
Well, I was born Louisa May Foster in the small town of Crawleyville, Ohio. Oh, I can't understand it. I never wanted money. All I ever wanted was to lead a simple life. With one man to love and to love me. A simple life somewhere in a little cottage. That's all I ever wanted. Ever since I was a little girl with my mother and father.
Oh, your mother. What was your mother like?
Mother? Well, mother kept Daddy and me clean, neat as a pin, and took us to church every Sunday.
So now I say unto you, love thy neighbor as thyself. 'Tis better to give than to receive. Money is the root of all evil.
Mother even had embroidered these very sentiments on samplers for our living room at home. But we were poor, and Mother found it hard to live up to these ideas.
Good day, Mrs. Jenkins. Sherman, did you see Emily Jenkins, that slob smothered in a mink cape?
I hate her guts.
Look what I've got. Her husband was a shipping clerk 15 years ago, same as you. Now look at him. Look at you. Where's your drive? Where's your ambition? That's what counts in this world. Success, money, success, money. President of the Nice Fellows Club. Oh.
Money, success. Get to the top. Money, success. Money, 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 money.
As the years went by, I saw my dear sweet daddy dwindle away under this, till you practically didn't know he was there. I began to understand what Mother really meant by those samplers.
You play your cards right, and we'll have more money than we need.
But Mother, money isn't everything. I know Leonard Crawley owns Crawley's Emporium and three quarters of the property in Crawleyville, but I'm not going to marry him just because he's the richest man in town. He's a sneak and a bore and a drag, and he's been with every girl there is, and besides, I don't love him.
There's no such thing as love.
He's a snob. He's ashamed of you and where we live. Why, he won't even walk in this house when he comes to call for me.
I wouldn't come in here either if I didn't have to. Louisa, you turned out real beautiful. You have something to sell. Take a mother's advice. Sell it now. Yes, Leonard, you better hurry.
No, I'm not going.
How dare you turn down a man like Leonard Crawley? I tell you, he has money. You go and get it.
Leonard was waiting. I thought over everything he had to offer. The Crawley home, the Crawley stables, Crawley's department store. But then there was Leonard himself. Leonard Crawley was, how shall I say it? Well, that's not fair, I guess. He was just Leonard Crawley, son of wealth.
Put it right down next to mine, baby.
Gee, I wish I'd said that.
Ah, you can use it anytime you want. Just give credit to Crawley.
That's more than Crawley ever did for anyone else in this town.
Oh, by the way, you better let your mom know that the payment's due on her refrigerator. Don't let her get the idea that because we're getting married, I'm going to let her off the hook. Oh, no. By the way, she couldn't be your real mother. She must have been left on your front doorstep one stormy night in a cage.
Why are you so intent on marrying me when it's perfectly obvious I'm indifferent to you and all of the so-called advantages you have to offer me?
That's just it, baby. You're the only girl in town who doesn't throw herself in front of me in the mud and scream, take me, take me. You know, you suggest good breeding. Heaven knows where you got it from. But also you produce me an heir, and then my mother stopped nagging me about carrying on the Crawley tradition. Any better reason than that for getting married? Hmm?
How about love?
Love? Well, let me put it this way, honey. I'm very rich and you're very poor, and sooner or later, you're gonna come around.
You know the indifference I felt?
Hmm?
Well, it's beginning to change. It's beginning to blossom into complete contempt.
But to tell you, honey, I told you you were gonna come around sooner or later.
Got to pick up the 6 o'clock town news for my store manager.
Crawley Gestapo.
Oh, yeah. Uh-oh, that eyesore. The only spot in town we don't own. But it's just a matter of time before old Hopper will come around. Just like you, baby.
Good afternoon, Mr. Crawley. Miss Foster, nice spring weather. All
right, make it fast, Driscoll.
Yes, sir. Mrs. Willoughby was 5 minutes late getting back from the doctor's today.
$5 fine off her salary.
Yes, sir. Hopper sent back the answer to your latest bid on his property. It's still no. He says he doesn't want to make money. He just wants to keep his little place as it is.
Edgar Hopper. I haven't run into him since high school.
I wonder how many days I get for manslaughter.
In Crawleyville, they wouldn't even find you, sir.
You better watch where you're going.
Yeah, you're right, Lenny. I was looking at the sun.
Aren't you angry?
Why should I be angry? It's my fault.
Well, then maybe we could fight.
Well, there's no sense doing that, Lenny. You'd kick the heck out of me. All that football and golf and tennis and everything. You're a real winner, Lenny.
What are you, an orthodox coward?
No, Lenny, I just believe in passive resistance.
Oh, Mahatma Hopper, I presume.
No, as a matter of fact, Gandhi and I both got it from this guy, Henry Thoreau.
You're all covered with mud, Edgar. Oh, I mean Mr. Hopper.
Louisa Foster, isn't it? Hey, I haven't seen you since Mrs. Pritchard's class. Hey, you've grown. Or maybe I shrunk.
Yeah, well, he wouldn't be covered with all this mud if he'd let the town pave that piece of road in front of his property like anybody else.
It costs too much, Lenny. For what you crawlies charge for a bag of cement, this town ought to be paved with gold. Thanks, Lenny. Hey, I gotta be going. I don't want to keep those trout waiting.
See?
Don't grow anymore, Miss Foster. You're just right now. Scared the fish away.
You could pull me in. I am full grown. You said so yourself. Thank you.
Sit down. Here, put this on.
Thanks. Did you catch any?
Well, yeah, three, including you.
I cooked them for you. My clothes are right down there. Do you have anything to cook them in?
Well, my baronial estate's right over there.
Is that where you live?
Yeah, kind of on the simple side, I know.
Simple, yes. Oh, our lives are frittered away by detail. Simplify, simplify.
What did you say?
Our lives are frittered away
by detail. Simplify. Simplify. A girl who can quote Thoreau.
Oh, I couldn't quote him before I went to the library this morning. I'd never even heard of him before yesterday.
You mean you didn't swim by my boat just by accident? Gee. Crawley doing here anyway?
Now, whatever gave you that idea about me?
Well, I don't know. Everybody in town takes it for granted. You are engaged to him, aren't you?
Well, he takes it for granted. But Edgar, as far back as I can remember, in grammar school, in Mrs. Pritchard's class, you know, when I sat in front of you, I wished that I had long pigtails so you could stick them in the inkwell.
Did you really?
I'm not going to marry Leonard Crawley. Of course, he'll never understand anyone turning him down. Especially for you.
Louisa. You mean you take this? Instead of all that? But Louisa, I've got nothing. I'll always have nothing. I'll always be nothing.
That's what I want. Nothing. To quote me and not Thoreau. I love you.
Oh, Louisa. I'll make you happy. I'll never work hard. I'll never make good. I swear it.
It's true, Mother. I've married Edgar Hopper.
Whereas Mother received the news of my marriage to Edgar with ill-disguised displeasure, Leonard took the news in his stride. For a while, Edgar and I led an idyllic life. He went off to the store a couple of hours a week, but the rest of the time belonged to us. As I look back on it, I see our life together as a wonderful old silent movie.
Gave a lot of trouble. Hey, you know, I'm going down to the store one of these days and get some chicken wire, fix these springs. You can do almost anything with chicken wire.
I sure do love chicken wire.
Leonard.
If you're thinking of running some up for dinner, ma'am, I'd be pleased to stay.
Hello, Leonard.
Hi.
Hi. Well, if it isn't a happy Hoppers at home. You know, I've been all over the world. It's the first chance I've had to come over and see you, lovebirds. You know, I saw the Taj Mahal by moonlight, Louisa.
Hmm.
Oh, but I envy you here.
What's that camera for?
Oh, I'm doing a documentary. Slum conditions in Crawleyville.
Oh, come now, Leonard. You needn't be such a sore loser.
Well, you gave me up for all this, and I can understand it, you know.
Nice roof under your feet, rain a face at night, all the grass you can eat.
Hey, Leonard,
huh?
Get out of here before I twist your head off like a turnip.
Well, is this the voice of passive resistance speaking?
No, just get out of here.
Well, another innovation for modern living, huh? Instant shower from a lady.
I'm afraid I'm not a bit handy, Edgar.
Oh, no, but you are handy. Perhaps I could use you down at the store doing odd jobs, and I'd pay you, and you could be earning a living.
No.
My wife doesn't have to work. I'm sorry.
Ed, seriously, Ed, why don't you come down and see me this afternoon and sell me that piece of property of yours? Someone could do something with it. Not you, of course, but someone.
I said to get out of here.
All right.
Get out of here.
All right, I will. I'm getting out. Sorry to barge in on you kids like this, but I'll send a Christmas basket.
Oh, nothing. I think I'll go down to the store for a little while this afternoon.
But you were there just 10 days ago.
Well, I've got that chicken wire I want and some nails. You know, it's end of summer. People come home from vacation. Somebody might want something. Oh, well, I'll be back.
But he never really did come back. Not the Edgar Hopper I knew. When he hadn't returned by the next day, I hurried into town.
This is the biggest sale in the history of our county. Don't call the crawling, folks. Hop, 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 hop. I hear you can't set off because there's no air conditioning. This is it, folks. undersell everybody. Come right in, folks. Instant credit. If we haven't got it, we'll get it for you, folks. Don't crawl the crawlies. Hop, hop, the hoppers. So all you shoppers.
Louisa.
What is all this?
Hopper's Taj Mahal, honey, and it's all for you. Listen, Louisa, when that snake rattled into our house, something snapped.
But where have you been? Why didn't you come home?
There you were, mending the roof, my wife. Hop, 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 you shoppers, hop to hoppers.
Honey, I want to get you things, dresses and things for the house, a house.
But I like our house.
Listen, what is it that makes a family go to the same store over and over and no place else?
Free eats, free toys for the kiddies.
That's it. We'll stuff them and then we'll sell them. Hop, 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 you shoppers. Hop, hop, hop to hoppers. Come on, honey, let me show you around.
Hey, you kids.
Get up on top there and keep with the hops, hop, hop, hoppers.
Eddie, this is wonderful.
Oh, thanks, folks.
Terrific.
Thanks for coming.
Hi, Eddie.
Hey, there's a lot more bargains here than that.
We'll be back, Eddie.
Okay.
Sometimes, Eddie.
Congratulations, Eddie.
Oh, thanks. The prices are low, the goods are right, so come to Hoppers from morn till night.
We'll
no kidding, we're open till 10 o'clock every night. How's it going there, folks?
Oh, great.
Good to hear it. Those
Edgar,
are all on sale.
When will we ever see each other?
Well, honey, as soon as this thing gets going, we'll have more time together than ever.
But we had all our time together before. What about Thoreau?
Thoreau?
But you don't want to keep pace like all the others. You heard a different drummer, remember?
Oh, yeah, I hear a different drummer, all right. And the music I hear says hop, hop, Eddie. Hop, hop.
Well, looks like we've got him at last, Driscoll.
Have we? The people seem to be eating it up.
Anybody will run to look at a freak. I figure I give him 3 months and he'll hop, hop himself right into oblivion.
Forgive me, sir, but we really must advertise.
What, huh? You're fired.
Mm-hmm. Merry Christmas and a hop, hop, happy New Year. Merry Christmas and a hop, hop, happy New Year.
Oh, that is no trouble at all, Mrs. Freeman, no trouble. You can't leave Hoppers. Hoppers leaves with you. Hey, Ned, you draw Mrs. Freeman off on the way home, okay?
Okay, ma'am. Oh, thank you, Edgar. And Merry Christmas.
Edgar.
Be right with you, lady. Merry Christmas to you, Mrs. Freeman.
Edgar.
Oh, hi, honey. Excuse me, I gotta get back.
But, Edgar, aren't you coming home soon?
Oh, I'm sorry, Louisa. We're staying open till midnight tonight. What's the matter?
Nothing. Just a little lonely, that's all.
What? In that big, beautiful new house, lonely?
I'm the only one who's ever in it. Edgar, it's Christmas.
But yes, and Christmas is business, big business.
You're working entirely too hard, darling.
Look, honey, by this time next year, we'll be so rich we can take a real vacation.
Italy?
Italy.
Merry Christmas.
Besides, what's the matter with work? A little hard work never killed anybody. Hi there.
And a hop, hop, happy New Year.
Edgar's hard work included hitting out with every modern sales device known to man. And Crawleyville was his captive audience. We were millionaires overnight.
Darling, I checked the hotels in Rome and I have the reservations for our vacation.
I'm sorry, honey, that'll have to wait till next year.
Next year?
Yes, next year. In the meantime, get yourself a couple of art books and a box of spaghetti.
Oh, you liar! You cheat! You deceived me!
Deceived me? You think I got a blonde tootsie on the side or something?
Oh, I just wish you had! At least then I'd know you were relaxing!
Schmimplify. A little hard work never killed anybody.
Edgar was like someone bewitched, like the sorcerer's apprentice. He couldn't stop.
Get me 300,000 feet of rust-proof chicken wire. Listen, what is with our order on the Mother Goose atomic disintegrator kit?
know. Make them think they can't live without doorknobs that light up in the dark. Think big.
Our musical mop, which plays Let Me Call You Sweetheart, I'm in Love with You, is a marketing failure. Get something happier like Stars and Stripes Forever to guarantee musical mop-up.
So it is just a simple equation. Service quotient X plus condensation atmosphere quotient Y plus smile and affability quotient X show in the last 3 months a sales gain line that has hop, hop, hop right off the lousy board. In short, boys, we are becoming, by the figures, the big, bigger, biggest.
In re yours of the 23rd, I am impatiently awaiting your order. Hastily, yours, Edgar Hopper. There can be no delays. If you insist on delaying, you'll always be replaced. Hastily, yours, Edgar Hopper. Since your delivery service has not been quick enough, we are terminating our agreement with you. Hastily, yours, Edgar Hopper. I'd like all those folders rushed out to the entire mailing list by at least Monday. Hastily, yours, Edgar Hopper. Order canceled. We ask you for goods. You gave us promises. Hastily, yours, Edgar Hopper. All the displays at all of the branch stores must be changed daily and rotated. Hastily, yours, Edgar Hopper. That is my final word on the subject. Hastily yours, Edgar Hopper. I've got to have 10,000 bed springs at once. Hastily yours, Edgar Hopper. Hastily yours, the hophead. Hastily yours, the boss. I like that all in triplicate right away.
Mr. Hopper, no one can work like this. The pace that's too fast. We're not machines. We're human beings.
Miss Bickford, there is no place here for anyone who cannot keep up with the pace of modern living. You are fired. My house, quick. You just closed the deal. My wife, hurry. Leonard Crowley just handed over the keys. Louisa. Louisa, Louisa.
Hello.
Louisa, it happened.
What's happened?
The next time you walk down Main Street, there won't be any Crowleys there. It's gonna say, Hoppers. Louisa, I did it. I wiped him out. He's through in this town.
Oh, I guess that's what you wanted, isn't it?
Oh, I got what I wanted. And I got money, wealth, success. Position. And next year, this town is going to be called Hopperville. And how do I get all these things? Through work. Just good, hard work. Which all goes to prove that a little hard work never killed anybody.
And outside of the bequest of one roll of chicken wire to Leonard Crowley, I bequeath my entire fortune and worldly goods to my wife, Louisa May Foster Hopper.
Edgar had left me approximately $2 million in cash and securities. And as Thoreau probably never said, that's a lot of lettuce.
But, my dear, you mustn't think that this in any way makes you a witch. Well, of course, it is tragic that Edgar died. But one swallow doesn't make a summer. Your behavior sounds exemplary, to say the least, very least.
Mm. Well, why did Edgar change that way?
Oh, normal. Quite normal. You see, he was the weakest of the tribe who had somehow won the prize, you, without really having had to fight for you. Latent feelings of inadequacy lay dormant until he was triggered by Leonard. Parading before you in his rich, many-colored feathers. Edgar naturally felt impelled to get even more feathers. And driven by this ego drive, he smothered in his own feathers. It happens every day, you know. Tell me, what happened to the other feather, or fellow, this Leonard?
I never heard from him again.
Dr. Stephenson!
Oh! 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 Oh.
relax. Oh, I'm terribly sorry.
There. Now, please, please. Just relax.
Yes.
Try to relax. You were saying about Leonard. Where did Leonard go?
Well, he just walked away like a plucked chicken.
Normal. Quite normal.
Yeah. Well, I put all the money in the bank, and I gave the house to Mama. And I took a small allowance for myself, and I got out of Crawleyville. I took a trip to Europe alone, to Paris. I wanted to forget, and I was determined never to marry again.
The bus tours were thrilling and exhausting.
Castella. Desjardins de. Essequip.
I ain't got all day, lady. Where do you want to go?
Oh, you speak English.
All of us foreigners do. It's compulsory.
You American?
No, lady, I'm a Russian spy for the CIA. Well, we'd be, huh? Go to the American ghetto at the bar at the Georgia Sank, or go visit some of your phony friends learning about life at Les Dumago.
Well, frankly, I'd like to do either, but I don't know anybody here. Et dis donc,
toi, retire-toi de là rapidement, hein?
Pourquoi?
Bah parce que je veux stationner.
Mais je suis là maintenant, vous démarrez.
Mais tu peux pas stationner ici, voyons, t'as une femme dans la voiture.
Non, c'est vous qui allez foutre le camp. Sans ça, je vais vous verbaler votre lance.
Sans blague.
Vous ne voyez pas que je suis en train de parler à une dame.
Oh, peut-être que tu me racontes la femme. Répète-toi, tu te saligons, tu te vas m'entendre.
Well.
Well. Well, I think I'd like to see some more pictures. I've just been through the Louvre, and that was wonderful.
The Louvre. Now, what is that? It's a garbage pail of the arts.
Et vous? Allez, allez.
Démarrez.
Well, how about the show at the Gallery Lafayette?
That's a department store, lady, but I'd rather hang up one of their face dolls than some of that other junk.
Listen, I'm sure you're an expert taxi driver, and I don't mean to belittle your profession, but why should I listen to your opinion on art?
Because I happen to be one of five people today who could definitely be called an artist. Maybe six, including Frida.
Who's Frida?
Chimpanzee on my block.
Oh, that's great. That's great. I mean, you'd see a technique like that, it just wipes you out. I go away.
What is it?
What is it? Innocence.
Van Gogh had it. But then he had to chop his ear off in order to free himself.
Free himself from what?
Intellectual hang-up. Now, if we could all do that, go back to a life like that, uncluttered, unhung.
Simple.
Oh.
Well, Frida had the best teacher in the world, you know, Rene Carrière there.
I'm very happy to meet you, Mr. Carrière. I'm Louisa May Hopper. You don't look anything like the Emile Desjardins it said you are in your cab.
The name is Larry Flint. I just take Emile's cab out for him once a year the day his wife has a baby.
Frida is finished now. It's a masterpiece. Look at the line and the color and the sweep and the texture. Marvelous. A testament to the human spirit. Total primitive articulation.
Does Frida's work sell?
Sell? You think Frida cares what her work sells? You think I care what my work sells? Typical American yardstick, the eternal buck. That's why I left the place.
Well, Mr. Flint, I was only asking.
What's that?
She's at it again.
Well, is someone being murdered? Are we going for the police?
Larry, we shot three already!
again.
Yeah, for weeks I thought I couldn't paint again, and now suddenly it's all come back.
One of the greats.
Oh, that picture makes me sick. Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Good. Feel sick. It should make you feel sick. It's destruction, pure and simple. That's what today is all about. That technique is her way of expressing it.
Oh! Ow!
What was I doing in Paris, 4,500 miles away from home? It was fate. I had come to meet Larry Flint, an unspoiled, dedicated artist, searching in his own troubled way for the simple life. Suddenly, I knew I wanted to share that life. Well, I never did go back to the Ritz. I'll never forget the wedding. Frida made a lovely bridesmaid. As a matter of fact, she caught the bridal bouquet and ate it. For a while, Larry and I led an idyllic life. As I look back on it, it all seems like one of those wickedly romantic French movies.
Ces seins, cette femme, vous qui aimez me l'embrasser les épaules, tendrement, c'est ceux qui veulent dire, voulez-vous coucher dans la chambre avec moi? Ben, écoutez, regardez ça, c'est merveilleux, c'est lèvres. Oh là là, Louisa!
Je ne veux plus attendre pour la tenir dans mes bras, pour presser mes lèvres contre les siens. Je veux me perdre sans honte dans la jungle de sa beauté. Je veux crier avec une joie sans mélange quand je la tiendrai pressée contre moi. Près, toujours plus près.
Most of the time, I kept house. Ah, la vie de bohème, le sacrifice d'amour.
This week's dinner.
Oh, darling, ah, beautiful. How did you?
Oh, for 752.
But, darling, that's one of your most beautiful paintings.
Well, we can see it any time we go to the butcher shop. Monsieur Blanchard has got it hanging right over the tripe and the sweetbreads.
But I've told you so many times in the United States and
won't
America.
Won't touch it. Not a nickel. Money corrupts. Art erupts.
Oh, that's a beautiful saying.
It's immortal. I just made it up. Hey, say, listen, why don't you bring some of that downstairs for me? Will you? I got some erupting to do.
Thank you.
much noise when you paint.
Ain't no other way, honey. Tools of my trade, like I told you, see, the sound, the sonic vibrations, they go in there, and then that gets transmitted to that photoelectric cell, which gives those dynamic impulses to the brushes and the arms. And it's a fusion of a mechanized world and a human soul. Well, it's the only affirmative statement being made in the world of art today.
I'm sorry, I forgot. It's a terrible thing being so dumb.
Why, you're really not so dumb, honey, because to tell the truth, I don't understand it myself.
Stupid to you, but what if we take a record and we put it on and we play it through the
sonic palette.
The sonic palette.
Silly kid, go ahead.
Oh. Mendelssohn's Spring Song. That's my favorite. I like the ones you make with your own noises. They're the real you.
Yeah, but, I hate to waste a good canvas, so I might try to pay a bill with it. Well, maybe the butcher won't know the difference between a real Larry Flint and a Mendelssohn. Hey, Louisa! Hey! Guess what?
What, darling?
I didn't leave it at the butcher's. I was there showing it to him, and there's this customer in there buying pig's knuckles. So he looks at the picture, and then he puts on his glasses, and he gives me his card, and he gives me 40,000 francs. That's almost $200.
Oh, why, that's wonderful, darling. All from that silly little idea.
Yeah, well, I gotta go downstairs and get to work.
I'll be listening for all those dear funny little noises.
Was a smashing success. Larry was famous and rich overnight. In the middle of this excitement, I was filled with apprehension, although I tried to conceal it.
Congratulations, Marsh.
I'm insufferably honored.
Translation, mais, s'il vous plaît.
Frida and I are very happy.
At last, painting which is music and music which is painting. How do you do it?
Joe, how can anyone explain the workings of the inner man? Actually, the act of creation might best be described as pure animal instinct.
If only Beethoven were alive to just hear this painting.
Ah, yes, poor Ludwig, I think he'd be very pleased.
Your paintings make me want to kneel, pray, and cry.
Well, in that case, Baroness, why don't you buy one? Then you can kneel and pray and cry at home.
Translation, master!
Flint, please let me introduce you to all Paris.
Well, thank you very much, but me wife and I don't take much to our places. We'll just go back to our little garage and attic. I got work to do.
But, of course, we didn't go back to the old place. We had a lovely house on Ile Saint-Louis, but Larry was never there. If he wasn't entertaining at the gallery, he was at his studio just outside of Paris. I was tired of being alone. Tired of wearing these ridiculous outfits Larry painted for me. What kind of life was this? I was just another canvas to him, just another walking catalog. Where was the simple life Larry and I had had, that vie de bohème? He was obsessed with success. I had to get him back. I couldn't let that happen to me a second time. Suddenly, I had an idea.
What are you doing here?
I haven't seen you in so long.
What do you mean? We had dinner together only last week. What do you want?
I have a surprise for you.
Aha!
Painting better than ever. Larry. Larry, we have missed you, Larry.
Oh, yes, I missed you too.
Larry, we have a picnic and bread and wine and cheese, and I thought we could all...
No, I'm sorry, but I'm working against a deadline. This mural's for Neiman Marcus. That's a department store in Texas. 150,000. We've got to get it rolled up and on a jet by tomorrow.
What are you doing up there?
Ah! God, I never should have had these damn things made in Paris.
What are you doing? Where are you going? Get back in line there.
What is the matter with you? What is the matter? Larry, why can't it be the way it used to be? Larry, I never dreamed this could happen. What is the matter with you? Larry, what is the matter with you? What is the matter? Larry!
Thank you.
par autres biens mobiliers immobiliers à mon épouse, Madame Louisa May Flint, demeurant...
Mon anglais, s'il vous plaît.
Pardon, madame. I, Larry Flint, bequeath...
What Larry Flint had left me in cash, plus the sale of his remaining pictures, brought me in the neighborhood of $4 million in American money. It was an amount even Picasso wouldn't be ashamed of. After several months of trying to lose myself in Paris, I decided to leave.
Trolley back to town?
Oh, Mr. Anderson. Should I have the plane?
No, no, I'll take it.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson.
Excuse me, Mr. Anderson. Overseas call, sir. San Francisco.
Excuse me. Hello? Uh-huh.
I recognized him immediately. Unbalding, glamorous Rod Anderson, Jr. Millionaire tycoon, up from riches. Inheriting $10 million from Senior Anderson's maple syrup empire. Unmarried, he seemed to have no trouble in getting what he wanted, in business or in pleasure.
Quiet. Thank you. Well, Mrs. Flint, where would you like to go? I was sorry to read of your loss. I saw you at one of your late husband's openings. I didn't buy anything, though. I don't like his paintings.
Well, I don't like your airplanes. Where are you going?
New York, Miami, Irkutsk, any place you'd like to go. I just flew in from New York this evening for some party. I stayed about a half an hour, and I'd had it. I don't like parties.
So you just put on your Superman suit and fly away home.
That's right. And there it is. Or don't you accept hitches from strange men?
Oh, I know who you are, Mr. Anderson. I just don't know if I'll be very good company. I just don't... I don't have much small talk.
I haven't any time for small talk either.
Excuse me, Mr. Anderson. Overseas call. Hong Kong calling.
Excuse me. Uh-huh. Yeah, huh? All right. Sell it. Thank you. Well, where shall it be?
New York.
New York it is.
What was I getting into? What was on that plane? I looked at the name of it. Melissa. Naturally, it would be named after a woman. I'd heard enough about those dissolute playboys.
Is ready.
Pretty name, Melissa.
It's someone I knew a long time ago.
Good evening, Mr. Anderson.
Good evening, Mark. Mark, this is Mrs. Flint. She'll be flying back with us. What sort of weather have we?
It's clear, sir, all the way through to New York.
Excellent. Good evening, Willard.
Good evening, Mr. Anderson.
Willard, this is Mrs. Flint.
How do you do?
Mrs. Flint will be flying back with us.
Yes, sir.
Her bags left on the 1119. You have them picked up at Idlewild and delivered to,
The Montclair Hotel?
Is that your favorite?
Well, I've never been in New York. Only for a few hours en route.
Mm-hmm. You better make that my suite at the St. Regis, will you?
Very good, sir.
It's reserved for visiting executives. I camp about 10 blocks further up the street on Fifth Avenue. And Willard, have the chef come round and take Mrs. Flint's order, will you?
Yes, sir.
You have anything you like. We have some rather fine wines aboard. I'll just have my usual.
Yes, sir.
Whatever you have is all right with me.
Oh, really? My usual has two soft-boiled eggs, gluten toast, and a glass of yogurt. And Willard.
Mrs. Flint will have the creme senegalese steak Diane, pomme souffle, profit roll with chocolate sauce, and break out a bottle of Latache.
Oh, very good,
and
sir.
That'll be all, Willard.
Thank you.
Now, let's step into the bar. Make you one of my very special martinis.
Oh, thank you, no. I'll have a scotch on the rocks. On the rocks.
Oh, very well. I was raised on maple syrup, you know. Cured me of drinking anything at all.
Oh, well, then I won't have...
No, 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 you go right ahead. Drink up. Good for you.
A telephone?
Watkins in Chicago. Excuse me. You know, you really are rather beautiful. But, is that your hair? Yeah, hello. Okay, you just sit tight. No, no, I think Prescott's bluffing anyway.
True, there was no orgy on board. He wasn't the Diamond Jim Brady of the jet set. But he was arrogant, cold, sure of himself, ordering people around. Another object lesson in what money and power can do to a human being. For all of it, he really seemed to be a miserable and lonely man. Why, he never even smiled. Not once had a smile lit that stony, sunless face.
Well, a tycoon's work is never finished, is it? That's what you call yourself, isn't it, a tycoon?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Every morning I get up and look at myself in the mirror and I say, good morning, tycoon. I know you don't approve of me, Mrs. Flint, but that need be of no concern to either one of us. I'm going into my office now. I've got some work to do. I promise not to interrupt by calling out points of passing interest or the weather conditions over Baffin Bay. I'll see you in New York, and don't forget to fasten your seat belt.
What was wrong with my hat anyway?
Okay, Mark, I'll take it.
Okay, sir.
I wondered who Melissa was. Some forgotten Hollywood starlet, no doubt. I was scared. I hated being alone during the takeoff. So beautiful looking down. The lights, the sky, the stars. How I wished I had someone to share it with, not this unsmiling airborne cigar store Indian. Then the fatal thing happened.
I'm glad you decided to join me. Nice to have someone to share it with, isn't it?
Beautiful.
Excuse me, sir. Telephone. Zurich.
Willard, tell the gentleman I just stepped out.
Did get to the St. Regis. We were married in New York, in his fabulous penthouse.
Thank you, Timothy.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay. I felt so safe at last. Rod had all the wealth and success he wanted long before he met me. I felt I couldn't possibly jinx his life. As for the mysterious Melissa, I decided never to question him about it. I dismissed it from my life.
A little trinket from Harry Winston.
As I look back on it now, our life together was like one of those glamorous Hollywood movies all about love and what'll she wear next.
Remind me to tell you later that I love you.
I'll remind you if you'll remind me.
Louisa, you look divine.
Sister, thank you.
You remember Peter, don't you, darling?
Oh, but of course. We met at El Morocco the other evening. You play beautifully. So nice of you to come.
Thank you. That's a beautiful dress.
Oh, I'm glad you like it. It's my favorite. My very own favorite.
I want to talk to you.
What is it, dear?
You remind me to tell you later that I love you.
Rod! Mickey!
Louisa!
Louisa, darling, here is someone you simply must meet. Darling, now you know Nicky Cathcart.
Wonderful to meet you.
Mrs. Cathcart. Louisa.
I do hope the two of you can come down to us for a shoot.
Mmm, love to. We always get a bang out of a shoot.
Remind me to tell you that I love you.
Remind you just as soon as I change my nightgown.
Lord Kensington? Lady Kensington, may I present my wife, Louisa?
How do you do?
So nice.
Delighted.
How do you do? We're so happy you could fly in for the evening.
I hope the two of you can come down to the Abbey this weekend.
Oh, we'd love to. But, darling, I haven't a thing to wear.
I'm reminding you to remind me to tell you that I love you.
Thank you for reminding me. I'm reminding you that you said to remind me to tell me that you love me.
Thank you for reminding me.
Thank you.
I love you.
I love you.
Why didn't he tell me before?
Hello, darling. I'm sorry I'm late.
Will you tell him that he's through? This is total disaster. How could it possibly happen to me?
What happened?
Louisa, ever since we got married, I've been neglecting my business. I've been so much in love with you that I've paid no attention to it at all. I've just let it slide. Well, I've just been reading these business reports.
Are you faced with ruin?
I am three times as rich as I was the day we got married. Nobody triples the business of Anderson Enterprises but Rod Anderson. Someone has been giving orders. Somewhere. Somebody in my organization. Well, that's absolute treachery. Someone's been giving orders behind my back. Imagine that. If I want to lose a fortune, I'll lose a fortune. If I want to triple it, I'll triple it. No one else. I'm going to get to every one of my offices all over the world, and I'm going to find out who's been running things behind my back. Triple it. How could he possibly triple it? Who can the guy be? You spend years training employees, executives, to serve you faithfully, and they stab you behind the back. That's loyalty for you. Willard, you make arrangements for trips to Sydney, Johannesburg, Hong Kong, and Bombay. I'm looking for somebody, and I'm not coming back until I find them.
I knew there was no man to look for. It was only me and my witch's curse. Sleep was impossible. Next morning, Rod would go out of my life forever and meet his doom somewhere. I was terrified. I tried to think of a way to save him. Melissa, happy days on his uncle's farm. The simple life.
Moo.
Hmm?
Moo.
Melissa? Melissa.
We had a simple, modest little farm. 2 dozen leghorns for me to look after. And a cow named Melissa, Melissa the second, and a bull named Melrose.
Well, Ma, how do I look? Neighbors all say I look real fine.
Wonderful, Pa, real elegant.
Have one more nip of our local cider.
Well, it's my fourth, and I'm not a drinking man, but seeing as how it's welcoming day, here's to you.
Thank you. Good day, Mr. Anderson. Good day, Mrs. Anderson.
Have another drink.
Oh, I'm driving.
I'm sure glad I'll listen to you. This is our first day here, and already I realize that this is what I always wanted to come back to. And you made me do it. Uh-oh. Feeding time. I'll go feed Melissa and you milk the chickens, huh? Been waiting a lot of years for that.
Can't I wait till tomorrow?
That shows how much you know about farming. You don't milk her now, and she'll be mooing all night long. Let's go.
Hello, Melissa, baby.
How are you doing, honey?
Just great, honey. That's a girl, Melissa, baby. Ooh, baby. Ooh, Melissa. That's a
rest of my holdings, cash and securities.
Several months after the funeral, I had to listen to the grim business details. Rod had sold out everything so quickly that his fortune was pitifully reduced. It came to a mere $150 million. I felt alone and lost, and I was determined to live alone for the rest of my life. It was the only fair thing to do.
Coffee here?
Isn't there any way of getting a cup of coffee here? What's your name, miss?
Louisa May Hop Anderson.
Isn't there any way of getting a cup of coffee here? Asked Louisa May Hopfle Anderson, pretty eyes, pretty hair, and she asks so clear, isn't there any way of getting a cup of coffee here? Louisa May Hopfle Anderson, huh? That's a funny name.
It's just Anderson.
Please stay, Miss Anderson. I'll get you a cup of coffee. Clancy must be out back somewhere. I'm in here all the time. Say, I hope you didn't think I was being fresh. That's just part of my act, you know. I get a list of the customers' names each night before the show, and then I make up little rhymes using all their names. It's one of my specialties, that ad-lib stuff. Coffee, sugar, Danish, served Danish. And for a big finale and a pin.
There's our Pinky. Always at it. Pinky, ain't you ever off the floor?
Why, it's Herbert Bodkin, I do declare. And Ernie Wilkins, who's with him there. I said with a grin, Ernie, your hair is getting thin. And Ernie answered, who wants fat hair? Oh, it's true, I never seem to stop being on.
No, I liked it. Are you performing around here?
Am I performing around here? That's me, Pinky Benson. Can I get you anything else? It's on me.
No, thank you.
What's on?
I got it, Clarence.
Thank you.
Say, if you're not busy later, would you like to watch my act?
I hadn't decided what to do later. I even thought of staying in this town for a few days till I made up my mind.
Well?
Well, sure, I'll come.
Good. I gotta kind of rush over there right now. It takes me 2 hours for my props and to put on my costume and makeup.
Oh, really? How's it going?
Well, the management must love me. I've been playing there for 14 years. See you later.
Lord, the world down, green bean, seven guys.
Here, over here.
Thank you, well.
Titus Billy Pink.
Hey, Albert.
Green bean.
That's better for you, no cholesterol. Mashed potatoes, well done.
One rare hash brown.
Hang on to French fries. Take it back.
I already made it back.
Ah, shut up.
I agree, but stop.
help yourself, honey. No man wants a fistful of bones.
Okay, okay. Here he is for your dinner pleasure. Jersey City's own, a Pinky, a Benson.
Well, good evening, friends and neighbors. Hey, who do we have here with us tonight? The Shimkins. Her Rosie Shimkin was able to get a ringside table. She's wearing a rose and a hat. And with her is her husband, Matt. And that is that. Dennis Horner is sitting over there in the corner. Hiya, Dennis. And Peggy Norton. Peggy Norton and her sister, Min, chewing on those bones like Rin Tin Tin. So, welcome all. Welcome one. Lend an ear and have some fun.
I think that you and I should get acquainted. I'll just come up to you and ask your name.
What I say is live and leave me alone. Say,
isn't the weather fine? And aren't you really glad? So glad that you came. Then after you and I become acquainted, I'll ask you if you'd like to stay a while. You'll say you would. You'll give me a smile. Goody good, you'll make my evening worthwhile. Before our little rendezvous ends, we won't just be acquainted. We'll be the very, very best of friends.
I could see why the management loved him. He didn't interfere one bit with the sale of food and liquor. Act I'd ever seen. Just looking at Pinky made me want to cry. But he was so happy and untroubled.
And I feel at home here, as you can see.
And in all the 14 years, you never wanted to play anywhere else?
Oh, you mean the big time? Mm-hmm. Boy, why does everybody seem to think you have to want to play the big time? Why? You get to the top of the ladder, you're a slave to your fans, you got no life of your own. Then you got to start worrying about staying up there. Huh? No. Not for me. I'm happy doing what I'm doing. And you know what? I teach dancing to kids in the daytime.
That's nice.
Yeah. My wife wanted me to get ahead. She wanted me to get an agent, press agent, publicity, audition, push.
Your wife?
Yeah, I was married once. We were a team. She always wanted me way up there. So I let her go.
And today, that woman is Greta Garbo.
No, she married a guy with a lot of dough, and she left the business. I don't blame her. I don't blame her at all. I was just a guy who wanted the simple kind of life.
And that's the story of my life as told to Louis Sevilla. Hop, 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 the Anderson.
Louisa May Hop Flint Anderson Benson. Yes, we were married, happily married, and we lived on our lovely houseboat on the Hudson. I told him I had a great deal of money somewhere, but both of us forgot all about it.
Oh, good morning, Mrs. Benson. Good morning to you. Good morning, Mrs. Benson. How do you do? I'll give you just one kiss. Then I'll stop, because I gotta give our little boat a mop, mop, mop. Boo, boo, ba da ba da boo, boo, ba da boo, 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 ba da boo, ba ba ba.
As I look back on it now, Our life together was like a gay musical number from one of those big Hollywood movie musicals.
Let's go. Life is just a vaudeville show. Sing and dance.
Take a chance.
Thank you.
began to happen. We were planning a birthday party for Pinky after the last show.
Well, I guess we got everything, the hot dogs, the rolls. Hey, look at the clock. I gotta get made up.
Oh, you've got time?
No, I don't. I have less than 2 hours.
It takes you 2 hours to get out of that makeup. You'll be late for your party. Couldn't you just skip it?
Skip a performance?
No, skip the makeup, I mean. Do it just as you are.
Oh, don't be silly, darling. The makeup's a whole act.
Here's the bucket of lemonade, Pinky.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Trentino, because of the party, would it be all right if Pinky went on tonight without putting on all his stuff?
Sure. You don't want to miss your own birthday party.
Okay, honey?
I feel naked. Oh,
leave out the verses, too.
Leave out the verses?
Just this once.
Well, all right, on account of the party, but I feel funny. I'm going to lay an awful egg.
And now for your enjoyment,
the
choices on Ha-Ha Boy, a Pinky, a Benson.
Let's get out of here. Waiter, check. Well,
Frankie dropped him in a second. I said,
hey. It was the fifth. I was there.
Trentino, can we have some relish?
Sure, help yourself.
Well, one rare hash brown.
I think that you and I should get acquainted. I'll just come up to you and ask your name. I'll tell you mine, I'll say, isn't the weather fine? And aren't you really glad? So glad that you came. Then after you and I become acquainted, I'll ask you if you'd like to stay a while. You'll say you would, you'll give me a smile, oh, goody good, you'll make my evening worthwhile, and before our little rendezvous ends, we won't be just acquainted, we'll be the very, very best of friends. That you and I should get acquainted.
I've grown accustomed to this place.
What? Caesar!
Cut, print.
Magnificent, Pinky.
Wonderful.
Magnificent. I'll never direct a better actor.
And to think they wanted to put that Welshman in the part.
Well, I was still near water, sitting by our beautiful Hollywood pool, alone. I'd done it again, And I'd lost Pinky. Lost him to fame, fortune, his agents, publicity men, secretaries, and his adoring fans.
How about my preview in Westwood last night, huh? What a gas.
Sure was, Pinky.
All those Pinky Benson fans screaming, yelling, crying. The little people. I love them. I love them. And if the studio tries to cut 1 minute of that film, I'm going to burn that nut house to the ground. 5.5 hours is not too long for a Pinky Benson fan.
Yes, Mr. Benson.
Now, about the premiere.
Everybody in the ball, see?
Hi, Louisa.
Hi, Pinky. Going in for a dip?
No, I'm going to Brown Derby. I got a business luncheon with these creeps. Ciao, baby.
Ain't you going to change?
What for?
You know you can't get in a derby without a tie on.
Jeez.
And Pinky, after lunch, you got to tape a speech to send to Jersey City.
Yeah, you told me. What's it for?
Pinky Benson Day. Big ceremony in your honor. Citizens are getting together to paint the front of the house you were born in pink.
Yeah? Gee, that's kind of sweet. I wonder who thought of that.
I did.
Yeah? Well, here's an idea from me. What's the matter with this place? The fans and the buses go by here every afternoon. Let's let them know without a doubt which house is Pinky's house.
This picture is a cinch to do 50 million at the box office.
Yeah, too bad I only get half of that.
Yeah.
And the studio wants you to co-star with Frank, Marlon, and Terry in a remake of The Four Horsemen.
Well,
why should I carry those dead weights? I'll play all four.
Come on,
Pinky,
can do
let's
it.
Get out of here. The mob is coming. Come on. Break it up, Pinky. Everybody out of here.
All right.
The co-star of Flaming Lips, Miss Linda Putty, another Pinky Benson discovery. Making new discoveries is the basis of our industry. And now, coming to our microphones, here she is, Mrs. Pinky Benson. My wife has always been my inspiration.
Pinky will never get out the front way.
Why don't you just slip out the side way, darling?
Yes, I guess so, but I hate to do this to them. After all, I'm what they came to see.
Yeah, yeah, we know. Come on.
So let's
this
go,
way.
Pinky.
Bring it up.
That's all.
We want Pinky. We want Pinky. We want Pinky.
The little people. I love them. Love them.
We want Pinky. We want Pinky. We want Pinky.
Ah, bless them. I can't let them down.
After all, I'm the stuff their dreams are made of. I belong to them.
Hey, Mullen! Mullen! Look who's here! It's me! It's your Pinky!
Look, it's Pinky!
Yes, Miss Benson, I know. But it's Willsville time in Dixie. And we've got to face the facts, death-wise, that is. So I'm going to give it to you short and sweet. You get all the moo, all of it. But there's one catch. And so I ordered to be built the Pinky Benson Memorial Museum dedicated to my fans. And within it will be preserved all my dancing shoes dipped in bronze and a giant gold replica of my larynx. A permanent pink light will burn before my statue, and the 15,000-seat auditorium. My pictures will run 24 hours a day. Everything else I bequeath to my wife, Louisa May Benson.
Pinky was right. He did belong to his fans forever. He was such a sweet man when I met him.
And then came...
Well, that's all. Why, isn't that enough? Oh, I was left with another $30 million, and I flew right here to Washington, and that brings us up to date. And I'm going to give that money away. The government's not going to stop me either, and neither are you. Please answer my question, Dr. Stephenson. Am I a witch or am I not? Well, you haven't said anything for the last two husbands. Not even listening to me.
Who? What?
Well, you're an analyst.
Huh?
What? Analyze.
Oh, that, yes. Now, let me see. You got married to four men for love. Mm-hmm. All of them were doomed to success and extinction. There was Hopper, Flint, Anderson, and Benson. And one man. One man you hated. That was Leonard Crawley. Well, that's a very strong emotion, hate. Say, you know, I think... Wait a minute, what do you expect of me? Instant analysis? Why, your case might take 24 hours a day for the next 50 years. In other words, Louisa... would you marry me?
Dr. Stephenson...
Look, if it's simplicity you want, you should see my apartment. I'm a dedicated man of science, and I'm so tired washing out my own socks. What do you say, Louisa?
Victor, I'm honored that you'd risk your life for me.
Thank you.
But it isn't fair. I simply don't love you.
No?
But would you mail my check in for me anyway?
Oh, please don't feel so bad. Maybe you'd help me after all. I said yes to four men and I said no to you. Isn't that progress?
Of a sort, I guess.
You see, after listening to my accumulated life story, you naturally assumed that I'd say yes. But you were wrong.
Wrong? I was wrong. I have the strangest tingling sensation in my...
Dr. Steph! Victor, are you all right? Wake up, doctor! Oh, dear. How do I get... I've got to... Oh! Oh, please help
me.
Would you please press that button and let this thing down? Dr. Stephenson...
Ma'am, I... What? Louisa.
Leonard Crawley.
What happened to the doctor?
He fell off.
Well, he always does.
Oh, Stephenson. Doctor. Doctor. Leonard.
Mm-hmm.
You're the custodian here.
Well, now, Louisa, let's call a spade a spade. I'm the janitor.
Oh, how awful.
Oh, no. I deserved it. You know, poetic justice is called.
But in a way, I ruined your life, too.
Oh, no, you made it. You know, when I lost everything, I just began to live. And I'll always be grateful to you and your friend.
Thoreau.
He said, simplify, and you can't get much more simpler than being a janitor.
Leonard.
Hmm?
You're the only man in the world I ever really hated.
Hate's a very strong emotion, you know.
But I think the thing I hated most was that I knew that deep down under that small town emperor, there was a human being that I wanted to know, and you wouldn't let come out.
Leonard, lunch. Stay long. All right, honey, now you spread these around. Jonathan, lunch.
Hey, look, Mom. Look what I caught. Sharks.
Well, wonderful. We'll have these for dinner. Now help your brother. Geraldine, lunch, honey. Now, don't you drop this.
What do you think I am? A baby?
All right. Help is on the way. Okay. All right, children. You can start your milk now.
Aren't we gonna wait for Daddy?
No, Daddy's finishing the plowing he started this morning. And the princess had four beautiful children. Leonard, and Jonathan, and Geraldine, and Butch. And they all lived happily ever after.
Ha ha ha!